and welcome to BYTE. I'm Nick Lockie. I'm a strategist here at 383 Project. And today I am joined by Bríd Brosnan, who's Innovation Officer at the British Red Cross. And we're going to be talking about user testing and validation and overcoming all those challenges that anybody that's ever works on a product has around trying to figure out the right direction to get going in from the start. So if you work in digital products, you'll know that assumptions often make an ass out of you and me and the roadmap that you've got planned as well. And to get back on track, you really kind of need to understand what your users want, what they're trying to do. And that means going out and testing some assumptions. And invariably, that can take time, effort, money, all the things that are the enemy of getting results fast, getting results right, and getting a real sense of confidence that you're doing the right thing. So today, I'm going to be talking to Bríd about how they try and overcome some of those challenges at the Red Cross, about how they approach innovation, and in particular about one of the projects they've got on the go at the moment, a really fantastic initiative called Leaps and Grounds. And in particular, we're going to be learning how to play validation bingo, which sounds really fun. I'm not sure whether you win anything like you do in an old folks home when they play there, but hopefully you win a really great solid roadmap and an idea of where you're going. So Bríd, thank you so much for joining us today. So shall we just kick off with a bit more about who you are and what you do?
Yeah, so I'm Bríd, as you said. I work as an innovation officer at the British Red Cross, so I'm part of our Central Innovation Hub, which was set up about 2.5 years ago, maybe 3 years ago now, which is kind of designed to help drive innovation across the Red Cross. We look at how we can, I suppose, lead the charge on some of the more disruptive projects, also how we can connect innovation efforts happening across the organization. And then we also investigate some kind of what we call big bets, which are longer term projects that are things we think could maybe be a step change for the Red Cross. I joined there in April 2021. And before that, I spent a couple of years working in delivery for a tech startup in Vancouver called Avenue HQ.
So what was what are the differences you found between the tech startup and the charity world then in terms of the approach to innovation and the receptiveness to what you're trying to do?
I think a lot of it is really similar, actually. You know, we've got a design approach that we use at the British Red Cross, I can share the link for afterwards, but it's kind of your standard, you know, you try and do a really good discovery and understand exactly what the problem is that you're trying to solve and define what success looks like. You come up with as many ideas as you possibly can, you try and validate those and choose the ones that are the most effective, and then prototype and test those in real life before starting to scale up. I think the difference for me has more been in having so many different sets of users when you work on things at the British Red Cross. You know, Leaps and Grounds is a great example. We're really trying to design something that can support or provide better opportunities for people who have been through the refugee process or the refugee experience to move into employment. But we're also then trying to build something that can be sustainable so that customers will want to support and purchase. So it has to work for them too. And then as a volunteer-led organization, we've got that third, I suppose, like set of user, that third group of users that we're really trying to design something great for them as well. So that's one big difference. And then the other big difference for me is that obviously Leaps and Grounds is not a digital product. So you're trying to apply these same techniques of rapid prototyping and testing as often as you possibly can and learning and iterating quickly, but for something that is real and out there and in the world. And I think that's where the kind of, the way that we looked at what can we test before we put something in real life became a really important part of making sure that we were doing our due diligence and validating all of our assumptions before we actually put a coffee cart in our office.
Well, that's a brilliant segue into Leaps and Grounds then. So you mentioned coffee carts there. Let's, for people who might not be familiar with what the project is, can you give us a kind of 101 on Leaps and Grounds and how it came about?
Yeah, sure. So it started actually in early 2020, so long before I joined the Red Cross. And it came from an ideas challenge that the innovation team ran across the whole organization. And one of the winning ideas was based on the experience of one of our refugee service managers in Wales. And they looked at the question that the innovation team took on to test and prototype in the course of 12 weeks was how might we create a service that could support refugees into work. And from there, the team who kind of had the project before I did a really brilliant discovery. They had to pause a couple of times and were redeployed due to COVID, and then they came back and did a really great discovery, did some really great co-creation with people with lived experience, with service managers who, you know, were supporting at the front line. And together they kind of formulated multiple different ideas, and the winning idea, I suppose, with one that we felt had the most potential, was Leaps and Grounds, which is a social enterprise coffee cart. The idea is that through flexible paid shifts on the coffee cart, women, refugee women, can gain work experience, they can build up their confidence, and they can have a chance to practice, I suppose, that more professional English language skills. Equally, it's an opportunity for us as the Red Cross to explore a new way to engage supporters, and it's the idea is that it will be a kind of a self-sustaining or potentially even a revenue-generating service over time. And that's kind of where I stepped in. So the project had been paused multiple different times. We had this really brilliant idea. We had had obviously a huge amount of validation had been done as we kind of developed this idea and selected this as the one that was worth prototyping. And I suppose I was kind of faced with something that I hadn't been part of, all of the discoveries and all of the conversations as we've gone along, but there was this really great idea with loads of assumptions built in. And so my first challenge was, you know, is this as good as it looks? How do we start to understand what assumptions we've made, and how do we start to test if they're true or not?
What's interesting there actually is, like, you've sort of come onto the project that already had some traction behind it. And then obviously there were a lot of challenges in terms of delivering something, especially real world, when the pandemic came along. So I guess there's two questions there. So first of all, how do you onboard, you know, how did you onboard to the project in terms of, like, how hard was it for you to get your head around everything that had been done before and get, you know, up to speed with the research and the insights? And then I guess the follow-up question to that is, like, what, from your awareness, just what difference did the pandemic make to the plan in terms of testing this?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I suppose the whole digital data and technology directorate across the British Red Cross, we work in the open. So we have regular show and tells, we blog regularly, we try to be as transparent and, you know, that kind of really embody that principle of working in the open as best we can. And that was invaluable to me when I was onboarding. I think I spent the first 2 weeks just watching the show and tells for this project, trying to understand. And that was, it was particularly valuable because you saw how it evolved, right? You weren't just looking at a finished piece. You were saying, oh, look, this is what the guys were doing in week two, and this is what they were doing in week six, and this is what they were doing, you know, in week eight, and this is how they went through these things. And you got to see, which again was really, really beneficial, what kind of questions people asked, what kind of worries were coming up when they're presenting to different stakeholders, what kind of questions were coming up. And it gave me a really, you know, as nuanced an understanding, I think, of the project as I could get without being there. And it was another, I think, you know, great, I hadn't thought about that element of the value of working in the open before, right? I'd never joined somewhere where you're starting brand new. I think a lot of the time when you work in this way, as you guys do at 383, and as a lot of people do across, you know, innovation and digital and product design, you expect to be part of every conversation and to be part of every piece of the journey, and it's not always possible. And I think that history of the project being public and being accessible meant that I could actually, you know, get as close to possible to the decisions that were made along the way. In terms of how it kind of changed the course, originally this was designed to be a 12-week really defined piece of work, right? So we were set up in early 2020 to investigate if we could answer this fantastic, you know, question of, can we design a service that can support refugees into employment? And the idea was that in that 12 weeks, there would be, you know, 3 or 4 weeks of discovery, a couple of weeks of ideation, and then there would be time to do this full test, like do a couple of weeks pilot at a location, where if it was, you know, obviously we didn't know what product we were going to come up with at that point, but, you know, time to fully test the idea within that 12 weeks. I think they were 3 weeks in or 2 weeks in when the first lockdown happened in March 2020, and the whole team was redeployed to support the British Red Cross efforts at providing relief to the completely changed society as a result of the pandemic. And so then a bit later in 2020, my colleagues who worked on this before, Alistair and Lucas, came back together and they did a second discovery on how the employment picture may have changed as a result of, you know, the huge change that we all experienced in this time. And then again, they refined the, I think at this time, actually, they refined the Leaps and Grounds idea. They decided this was the one we wanted to test in real life. And they were just ready to do a 1 week pilot when that October lockdown happened again. And so again, you know, different people left the team and moved on to other opportunities. And people felt that there was, it wasn't the right time, obviously, in lockdown 2.0 to start to test something like this in real life. It wouldn't have been a fair test. It also, you know, was a time where it was saying, you know, work from home, stay at home. It wasn't a time to open something that brought people together and had people in close proximity, obviously. And so it kind of snoozed then until I joined in April or late April of 2021. And again, you know, it's been snoozed multiple times since. Originally we hoped to pilot in June, and then restrictions didn't lift as quickly as we thought, and kind of continued to push back. But actually, that has proved to be a really interesting constraint, because if we hadn't had that those delays that were forced by circumstances, I'm not sure that we would have done the amount of kind of pre-testing that we've been doing since then. And that's kind of where I suppose I kind of was able to employ a lot of the things that we might have used in a technology context to test assumptions that we had built into this model. So a great example of that is, when we looked at our ideal version of this product, we hoped that it would be something that, like everything else that we do at the British Red Cross, could be volunteer led. And we had absolutely no idea whether that was something that volunteers would be interested in. We had no idea whether, you know, ideally we wanted to attract volunteers who had barista skills already, because as we know, that would create a really great environment on the coffee cart. You know, if you've got someone who's an expert and they're able to support someone who's quite new to the skill. And also we knew that that would be really great for consumers, right? You know, you're guaranteed a really good cup of coffee. We had no idea if it was true or not. We just wanted it. When I joined and after I tried to understand exactly where we were, we mapped all of these assumptions against what was feasible, what was viable, what was desirable, and kind of what we assumed would be impactful. And from there, we looked at some of the things we knew a lot about already. So because my colleagues before had followed this user-led evidence-based process, we knew that, you know, this would solve problems, and we knew that it was something that was of interest to users, because we would have discounted this idea much, much earlier if those things hadn't been proved true. It was more the kind of nuances of the idea and the more detailed assumptions that we had much less evidence about, but actually would be hugely impactful, right? Like, it's a hugely impactful for what this idea is and how this could grow if volunteers are interested in being part of it. And so because we couldn't test, you know, straight away, we looked at how can we run these tests really quickly and really cheaply and kind of validate our assumptions so that we can either pivot or move on. And so with the volunteer element, I had a lot of conversations with different people across the coffee industry to try and get up to speed on, what it was like to work here and you know, kind of upscale that understanding that my colleagues in the past had already developed. And so one of the things we found is that most people who are experienced baristas, when they look for jobs, they look on Coffee Jobs Board. So we were like, oh, great. And we ran an ad for Coffee Jobs Board for a month. And I think it cost us £15 to run it as a promoted ad. And we said, okay, we're going to run it as a blind ad. We're not going to say that it's us as the Red Cross. We're just going to run an ad for this project, put down some sort of, you know, requirements. I think we said, you know, could you commit maybe four hours a week? What is the idea? And we set ourselves up some confidence in intervals. So if no one applied, we knew that we were onto a loser and we'd need to change the model and think about if it was still, you know, a feasible or a viable idea if volunteers weren't interested. If we got up to five applications, we kind of agreed that, you know, this was fairly solid actually, because to be honest with you, the ad looked a bit dodgy. There was no information about the company or the, who was going to be delivering this volunteer role. And we thought if five people are willing to do this, we could probably bet that with all of the, with a better branding opportunity, with more Q&As, with an actual real ad that doesn't look dodgy, that we can leverage that. And so obviously if we got more than that, we were 100% sure. And actually the question would then be, you know, can we go farther? Can we ask for more experience? Can we refine this even farther? And so we ran that for 2 weeks, I think, actually, the ad, and we got 5 applicants in 2 weeks. And for us, that was kind of, you know, enough. It felt like, yes, our numbers come up. We've defined the test. We've set ourselves some fair parameters for results. We've met that. Now the question is, can we create a journey that works for this new type of volunteer? Can we make it as lightweight, as simple, as easy as possible? And we did some work to get that set up, and we did some work to get the role approved internally, and now it's live. So now we're recruiting volunteers, and we can see, you know, again, we're using Coffee Jobs Board, but we've got a more formal and more legitimate role live on our website, and we can see if anyone does apply for this one. And if they do, brilliant. And if they don't, we've learned. And then the next test, I suppose, in this piece of the journey is, when people have applied, do they do the training that they need to do? Do they sign up for any shifts? Do they actually turn up? And all of this is just designed to learn. If we're wrong, we're wrong. At least we know before we've committed too much to the idea. We have time to change the plan. We have time to adapt and to learn and to develop something that does work.
So it's that classic lean startup approach then, just kind of like picking the assumptions that are the most critical to get the product done, and then figuring out how you're going to test them, how you're going to have confidence in the results of those, and then moving on to the next big thing that you need to test.
Yeah.
So with the we talked before, and looking at your blog post, you mentioned a technique called validation bingo, and I know you've kind of gone through a lot of the process on that. But can you talk a little bit about the specific tools and techniques you were using to weigh up what were the most critical challenges and which ones that you would then face next as you went through?
Yeah, so we used I suppose like a couple of different matrices when we were getting started to map all of our assumptions. So I mentioned before that, you know, first we put them on what was related to feasibility, what was related to viability, what was related to desirability, and what was related to impact. And we took some of that modeling from the testing or validating business, testing business ideas book, which is a really good book. We can share the link to it afterwards. It was, I suppose, like these were things that we would be doing anyway, but I really found the canvases useful to force you to make sure you had every single assumption down. From there, we looked at taking those same assumptions and plotting them on and evidence versus impact graph. So what were the things that were the most impactful that we had the least evidence for? And then those became the first things that we tested. And then we had the second test and the third test, etc. And I suppose like what was, you know, the kind of idea of playing bingo with these is that you, much like a bingo card, you set up, okay, these are the tests we need to do. These are the critical ones. This is, you know, card one. And all of these things, or some of these things, need to come up for us to be able to get bingo and move on. And if they don't come up, then we have to accept that this model isn't the one and something needs to change. And setting up all of those tests in advance and saying, these are the tests, and it's as simple as that, forces you to be evidence-led, which I think, you know, all of us who kind of work in this area and field, we want to be evidence-led and we want to be user-led. But it's also really easy to get caught up in your own idea and to think, well, this is brilliant and it has to work and so much work has gone into it, so it should work. And I think kind of laying that out for yourself, you know, we use the test cards that I mentioned that said, this is the test. This proves it's really true. This proves it's only okay. This proves it's absolutely rubbish. And setting up kind of all of those and then seeing what happened with them and how the kind of bingo numbers came up allows you to, I suppose, force yourself to be evidence-led and to feel like, actually, if it fails, it fails. It's just the numbers didn't come up and we'll, you know, see what the card looks like. So, you know, for example, obviously you want everything to succeed all the time. And so far we've been pretty well validated in what we've explored. But if something doesn't come up, you then have to assess whether the fact that the other things did come up mean you can pivot and it's just a bit different than what you expected, or actually this is the center of the idea and without it, it can't go on. sorry. And I suppose for us, like, we're gearing up now to try and run a real life pilot. So the things that we're testing in advance are more determining how the pilot should look and what we should really be focusing on testing at that point. Because there are things that you can't test until, you know, you can't test if we can make a good cup of coffee until we have to make a cup of coffee. We can't test how many people are going to come to the coffee cart until it's there. But what we can do is, you know, put out our designs for the coffee cart and see which are most attractive to consumers. We can run those smokescreen tests for volunteering ads and see if people do sign up for them. And testing as many of those things in advance give us the confidence that we're designing the right test for this 4-week pilot that we have. But they also help us to, I suppose, be more validated as we move through, and each one helps us to gain more momentum and really believe more that this is a good idea and something that we should do.
I think one of the things that struck me from your blog actually was we'll definitely share the link to this afterwards. It's a fascinating blog. You're on about the subsequent test you did on the volunteer principle of, like, you know, how do we get our, you know, I guess the outcome, you know, we're big fans of outcomes rather than outputs of 383. So what's the result we want to get rather than the methods that we get hung up there. So I guess, like, the outcome that you want around the volunteer thing is to have somebody with expertise of making a great cup of coffee on hand to support the refugee women on the cart. But what you're trying to figure out is, you know, do we find baristas and make them volunteers, or do we find volunteers and train them up to be baristas? You know, it will get you to the same outcome, but both of those require thinking about and narrowing that down a little bit, which I thought was a really interesting take on it. And I was just wondering whether if there anything that's in particular that's caught you out or required a learning curve with this transition to testing and designing a real world, I guess, piece of service design as opposed to software design?
Yeah, I think for me, definitely. I think actually at the moment, I'm kind of going through that big learning around, like, I like to work in sprints, on a Friday, I'll decide what I'm going to do on that Monday. I don't love a big detailed project plan. I prefer to kind of go where the evidence leads me and know what could we do next, but not necessarily say it has to happen in this order or it has to happen at these times. And you do have to do that if you want to put something somewhere. You do have to think about orders and timelines and deadlines and, you know, at what point do I need to have made this decision by so that all of the stuff can actually get there in time for us to open on this date. And I think that has been, I suppose, like, we've got a really good team, and I think that's helped, because, you know, I think if I was doing this on my own, I might have let that run a bit longer and not necessarily have paused and been like, actually, you know, are we going to have enough time to make the flyers that we want to make, and how long will it take to print them, and how long will it take to, you know, do all of those really practical things? Whereas I suppose I, coming from a digital background, you know, you can do anything you want in the time. You might have to work late, you might have to, you know, especially if it's not a big build, you can almost always, you know, build something with a third-party software that can happen instantly. And that's not the case when you need to put cups on a table or get beans in a bean hopper or, you know, find a machine. You have to think a little bit more about the deadlines and the you know, the dates that something needs to happen. But so far, I think in terms of our assumptions, we haven't been too badly caught out. It might be coming, but not yet.
In terms of the culture of innovation within the Red Cross, I mean, you guys sound really forward thinking within the charity space, but I guess the motivations might be different than just, like, you know, trying to sell something to an end user. And you know, there's obviously all sorts of things to consider within the sort of the charity model. To what extent are you dealing with kind of culture mind shift with what you're trying to do through these experiments, or is it quite receptive already there?
I think it depends on what you're trying to do, to be honest. Like, I think you're right, you know, it is definitely a different space, and obviously, you know, the appetite for risk can often be different because you're, I suppose, in a position where you're trying to deliver outcomes for people in crisis, right? You know, that's everything that we're trying to do, is trying to deliver great outcomes for people in crisis. And our job in innovation is to push for something that could be a step change and be really responsible in de-risking that before we put too much resource behind it. But also, you know, it is new, right? And I think what I've actually enjoyed most about working on this project is working with people across all of the different teams to talk about how we can try different pieces. And, you know, you're dealing with people, like fantastic people in our property portfolio who've really helped us to think about the best places to put this and how we can work with it. We're working really closely with, you know, health and safety, with people from our volunteering teams, with our branding teams, you know, and everyone has been really receptive actually to, like, you know, this idea and helping it to become a reality. I think as a wider team, as you mentioned, you know, our goal is to transform the way the organization thinks about innovation and thinks about innovative ideas so that we can become redundant. And our head of innovation, Jess Ferguson, wrote a really good blog on this actually about a week ago on kind of how far we've gotten to at this point and on where we think we are in terms of our maturity and where we might want to go next. I think we've definitely found that kind of doing things together with different parts of the organization to create something new is a really great approach to fostering this sense of innovation and creating things that are out there in the world and trying those things together with different pieces of the organization is definitely, I think, kind of how we plan to move forwards.
Yeah, there was that, you know, the classic kind of, I guess, bit of ad copy from the advertising industry was always the, you know, give a man a fish and he'll eat for a day, and teach a man to fish and he'll fish for a lifetime. And I guess there's kind of like, that seems to be what you guys are trying to do, you know, rather than be the team that executes for everybody else. There's that kind of like supportive kind of being evangelist for the process and just getting everybody to think in that way. And that just seems like a, you know, I find it really interesting that it's almost kind of like the redundancy of your function as a department is almost kind of like an ideal.
Yeah, literally, it's the strategy for the Innovation Hub is to be redundant. When it was set up, was to be redundant in 10 years, to, you know, come in and be a central place while we needed one, but ultimately to not hopefully need one. And it's difficult for me to kind of, you know, say, hey, that's gone, because obviously I've only just joined. But I do think it's something that is growing across the sector as well. You see a lot more charities, you know, thinking about what innovation looks like for them and thinking about, you know, how to leverage the capabilities of digital on the whole. And I think there's really interesting things happening kind of across the Red Cross on this, and our digital and innovation, digital data and innovation blog area is interesting if anyone's interested in kind of, you know, keeping up with the kinds of things that we are doing.
Fantastic. So in terms of leaps and grounds then, so where next? What's the next step with the project?
Yeah, so we're still aiming for a 4-week pilot, hopefully, around the end of September. A lot of the work that we're doing now is kind of gearing up to that. In terms of the tests that we're running, we're kind of in phase two of testing that volunteer journey to see, you know, you're interested on paper, but are you interested in reality? And will you actually come along? A big part of also what we're doing is double checking, I suppose, that the ideal outcome in terms of the impact for our service users is going to be valid. And that's something that we really can't be sure of until we give this experience on the cart for a few weeks and see what happens next. So we're aiming to be open from our Red Cross UK office from kind of late September to early October.
And what's the, if you had to do things differently up to the, you know, from based on what you've done now, what would be the biggest change that you would make to your approach?
I think we've struggled because of restrictions. Like, I think in hindsight, you know, some of the things that we have tested, you could argue whether they were necessary to test this early on. You know, we had the time to test in advance, so we did, and we couldn't necessarily move to a real life version. I think if we were to have done things differently, we might consider moving ahead earlier and thinking about more domestic locations. You know, would it have been better to try and pop up in a neighborhood if people are all working from home and validation's learning sooner? Or would it have been better to, I suppose, like, run more simple tests, if that makes sense? Like, you know, did we need to bring in the volunteering element at this point? Like, I would argue, yeah, it's really useful, but like, could we have skipped it and kept our ideas simpler and validated more and then maybe we move more quickly? But I think that's another big thing, isn't it, with this kind of way of working, is that as you learn things, you always think about things that you would have done or could have done differently, but all you have is what you have and what you have done, and then what you do with that next.
Yeah. And as not just from the point of view of leaps and bounds, but as a product person and the sort of innovation professional in the field, what's the best piece of advice that you could share to product teams in order to make a difference with the products they're making?
I think it's being user-led, not in the tools and the practice, but in what actually people are telling you and showing you. And I think a lot of the time, it's still the hardest thing to do, even though we all want to do it. It's still some of the most difficult things is to say, well, I've designed this and it should work, but it doesn't. And accepting that it doesn't, and I have to listen to why it doesn't and what needs to change from it. And I think I always try to treat it like a game as much as possible, because it makes it easier to say, oh, I didn't get this one, but it's fine, I can change it and do the next one. It makes it less difficult to kind of be open to change. And change is the only constant, right? As you develop any product, the only thing that you can be sure of is that you're going to have to change something about it almost all of the time. So that really trying to find a way to let yourself be led by what people are actually telling you rather than what you want them to tell you, I think is the best piece that I've definitely learned and been trying to implement.
Fantastic. Well, I'm off to design my own validation bingo card after this and have a bit of fun with that. Thank you so much today, Bríd. That has been a fascinating chat. Some really good insights and what a fantastic initiative as well. I wish you all the best with that and looking forward to seeing how Leaps and Grounds turns out for you. So that's it for today's BYTE session. We'll have more sessions coming up in the future, so keep an eye on what we've got on the website. There's loads of great product advice on the 383 website. If you want to talk to us about innovating your own products, come and have a chat and check out our YouTube channel as well. Thanks for your time. See you on the next episode. Bye.